This program is brought to you by Emory University.
Okay, my name's my name's Paul Blackmore. I'm English. This is my son James. He will be giving the talk today. As you can tell, I've spent a lot of time in Africa, particularly Central and West Africa, and I actually had the fortune to live there for a best part of 10 years running a big conservation project in Cameroon, on Mount Cameroon. That's Mount Cameroon. I'm going to show you slides about the region and about the people who live there and about the fact that they derive almost all of their medicines and foods from the forest. One thing we always forget in our society is that there are whole communities out there, hundreds of thousands of people deriving their entire living from the forest. And protecting the forest isn't just about global warming or carbon sinks or erosion control or loss of biodiversity. It's also about protecting people's livelihoods, because one of the big problems with forests is that when you don't cut them down and when you do constantly go along and pick things, there is a huge economy that's not measured. And that's one of our problems. And one of the things we were trying to do, and my wife does, is to try and figure out all that value, that wealth that's coming out of the forest. Is it better to leave the forest standing, or is it better to replace the forest with something else? So I brought up a lot of different things. Everything on this table comes out of the rainforest, yeah? And we have, start this end. We have things like baskets and coloured cords, natural dyed. All of this is natural dyed. This is a utility basket for a child. You will see a child younger than my son walking down the road with this packed full of fruits, vegetables, firewood, and then mum would be carrying this, and this would have 60 pounds of yams in it or something like that. But all of this is made in the forest, on the forest, for the forest. It's just all made locally. Climbing harnesses, bags, toys. You know, you can't afford a rubber ball, so you have to make one, yeah? Music, and various other things. So what we're going to do, we're going to go through the presentation. You can ask questions at any time. If you can't understand what I'm saying, I'm used to that. Nobody understands what I say, so just speak to me. Yeah? Just say, hey, what are you saying? You're talking gibberish. So where's the control?
There's no
clicker.
Just use
no.
The answer.
Sorry. Okay, that's great. So Mount Cameroon is an amazing country, yeah? Unfortunately, it's referred to as the armpit of Africa, yeah, because as you can tell, it's in the armpit, yeah, and it's really smelly, yeah, that's why they call it the armpit of Africa. But joking aside, what it is, it's a hinge, and this part of Africa's moving down, and this part of Africa's moving up, and what you've got is this huge crushing, and so you've got an extremely mountainous country. It's got the highest and most active volcano in Central Africa. It's about 4,000 metres. The geography is extremely severe, so you have a lot of forest, a lot of segregated forest, which leads to a lot of evolutionary development and a lot of specification, a lot of centres of diversity for hundreds of different crop plants and medicinal plants. And up until the 1890s, you had hundreds of communities living in this forested and mountainous area that weren't connected. It was only when the Europeans started to explore, move things around a bit, that everybody started getting connected. But the important thing to remember is that if you took Cameroon away from the rest of Africa, you pretty well would have a small model of the whole of Africa. It has forests, deserts, mountains, volcanoes, beaches, rivers, everything you want. The forest zone pretty well comes up to here, and then it's sub-Sahara all the way up to here with totally different communities there and there. So it's a really amazing place. The fault line runs from down here, the island of Principe, up through Equatorial Guinea, Fernando Po, Mount Cameroon, Mount Etinde, all the way up to Garoua. So this whole chain of old volcanoes and active volcanoes are still there. So the other thing to say about it is it's 21 million people, yeah? It's the size of California, 21 million people, 282 languages. Everybody speaks French and English. Every kid learns French and English. They learn their dad's language, they learn their mum's language, they learn a couple of others. So you'll see six-year-olds who are linguists. Linguistics is fantastic. So it's an incredibly diverse culture. So let's move on to the next slide. Any questions? No?
Space
the big one. No, you said the space for. Oh, no. Sorry.
I used to have a clicker.
You can laugh if you want. I'm used to it. Okay, which one? Which one did you press? Oh, great. Okay, that's great. Yeah. Okay, here's a. Now, why was I in Cameroon? Well, I was sent there by the British government to work as a botanic garden development manager for the government of Cameroon. It's a bilingual project. Cameroon and government of Cameroon, British government, oh, and French and the German government, we got together, and there was a 120-year-old botanic garden. And the idea, it was established by the Germans in 1890, and it was still there, and it was huge, but it was totally run down. So our project was to renovate it as a garden, but then to turn it from a botanic garden into a biodiversity conservation centre for the whole 250,000 hectare mountain. Because in Central Africa, this is the last place after the Congo, on Central West Africa, this is the last place that is still from sea to 4,000 metres, still intact. Yeah? And there are 300,000 people living around there in the assortment of towns and villages, and three major tribes, the Dawalas, the Bakossi, and the Bakweris. And we went to the tribes and said, what do you want this garden for? They're insanely proud of this garden, because this is another example of a botanic garden literally giving birth to a country. Germans built the botanic garden, started to open up all this area, and they built the botanic garden for one and one only purpose, and that was to research, introduce research and develop crops, cash crops that were going to pay for the development of this country of Cameroon. And so the garden is actually the oldest thing in Cameroon. So we went along, what do you want us to do? And they were like, we want medicinal plants, we want this, we want spices, we want things that we don't want to go into the forest to harvest. So that's what we were working on. There's a satellite picture, and it's very interesting. The volcano only erupts every 20 years, but I was there 10 years, it erupted three times, yeah? And you can see it, really angry mountain. I mean, it's a composite volcano, yeah? It's not like Mount Fuji, oh, it's going to erupt there. No, it erupted here, yeah? And no one's really sure. 1920s, it erupted there. 1940s, it erupted there. 2000. Year 2000, erupted there, it flowed down the mountainside, it went right by the town where we were living, killed all the fish in the sea, which everybody likes because they ran out and got the fish, and cut the only road to Nigeria, which is here. So it was quite a fun day, quite a fun time. It took 6 months for it to roll down the mountain. But we saw it, and it kept erupting all the time. So as you could see, though, it's grasslands, montane forest. The montane forest is under the cloud forest. Different levels of forest until plantations here. And so it really is an intact ecosystem. And it's exceedingly rich. Oh, well, God, I stopped that. Okay, so why is it really interesting? Well, it's an extremely varied geography. And that always leads to a really diverse ecosystem, yeah? It's biodiversity rich. It has every kind of tropical habitat you could wish for. Grasslands, riparian lands, mangrove swamps, cloud forests, montane, lowland tropical rainforest, all sorts of things. It even has a mini desert in a rain shadow on the other side of the mountain. It has a rich and a well-established indigenous population. As I say, Bokossi, Bakweri, and Douala people lived there for 1,000 years, maybe. We don't know. But they've lived there a long time. And it's the Botanic Garden itself pulled together all the modern skills. We had a herbarium, libraries, nurseries, horticulture experts, biologists, and we were a center for a magnet for thousands of research scientists coming out, paying to use our facilities and getting permission to explore the mountain. So it's a really cool place. Some of the things, this is a view from my bathroom, believe it or not. The American ambassador visited and he had dinner at our house and he said, "You've got the finest bathroom I've ever had the pleasure to use." But these are the pirate isles. Up until the 70s, there was a bunch of people living in there called the Bokossi, and they used to literally be pirates. Yeah, they would rob the fishermen, they would rob the trading ships, and then if to get their fresh water, they would have to trade the stolen goods with the land people to get water. The government took them away in the 60s. But as I said, there's mangrove swamps, there's dense tropical rainforest. This is the oldest mountain in Central Africa. It's called Small Mount Cameroon. It's here, Mount Cameroon's here. And this thing is so old that it's got its own unique rock. The mountain itself is called Mount Atindi, and the rock is called Atindinite. And no one is allowed to set a foot. This is as close as anyone can get to this dense tropical forest, because this area is the most sacred thing in this part of Cameroon. So it's a burial ground for the tribes. It's very important. So, but we were allowed to explore for plants, and numerous species, new species, were discovered all over that mountain. As I said, it's a volcanic island. If you've ever lived near a volcano, it's really disruptive, yeah? I mean, it can change your life dramatically. And this, it exploded, and you know, 3 weeks later, this was coming straight towards the Botanic Garden. Fortunately, it took a right and went into the ocean. But the sad thing about volcanoes is they're incredibly destructive. But the good thing is that the biodiversity in the area, the soils and the fertility of the area is incredibly rich. We had a program where every time there was a volcanic eruption, going back to 1922, we would set up biodiversity monitoring plots and basically see how the succession, the forest, came back. And then on top of that, this shows, this is not man-made, this is how it is. You walk up the mountainside, it's a killer to climb, 2-day hike, and the forest literally ends and the grasslands start. This is about 3,000 meters. Off 60 kilometers away is Equatorial Guinea, Fernando Po. So it's a really interesting area. Let's go on to the people. The people are really interesting. Cameroon is 3,000 miles from Britain, but in some ways, it's not the distance in geography that matters, it's the distance in time. You have a sophisticated, well-educated population of people who live in the forest. The Bakweris would live in the forest in their huts, and they are huts. And you go along and they've got laptops and mobile phones and solar cells. And they live their traditional life using our technology to talk to their family all over the world. And they're a really interesting thing, because what struck me immediately was they have a foot in a world that's long gone and a world that's coming fast. And they did not give up their traditional ways. They don't dress like this every day. This was one of the many festivals every year. In October, they have a really important festival called the Elephant Dance, when somebody dresses up like this, and they dance a ceremony for a week, and he'll go from village to village to village. And they basically, it's kind of when they take the young boys, and they're 14, 15 years old, and they kind of take them out on long hikes and stuff, and it's a very watered-down part of an old-fashioned man-making ceremony, but it's still practiced. Why is it important? Why is it interesting to us? Well, because What's really interesting to us is that their whole concept of the world is controlled from the past. So their medicine, for instance, if you went to a Bakweri doctor, he's not going to take your blood pressure and your temperature and say, yeah, you need to take this. He's going to use a combination of plant products, tradition and ceremony. See, medicine, he would have to, I wouldn't wear this when he was doing his job, but the whole traditional thing, the whole traditional past, yes, is very much a part of modern medicine there. So medicines are prepared with people who wear masks, with drums, with different things, different cultural things, songs and different processes that prepare medicine. So it's all very much a spiritual thing rather than just a prescription. So, as I said, Cameroon has got 25,000 different species. It's incredibly rich. One of the projects we had was to find all the plants and list them in this inventory. And that was a product of 20 years of work. We ended up with a herbarium with 40,000 specimens. And that was all done working with the local people. Now, when you go to a market in Georgia, Atlanta, you're going to see the same stuff you'll see if you go to a market in England. But the one thing that's really cool about tropical markets is you'll see a few things that you recognise, and almost everything else is not recognised. Yeah, I mean, some of the things are obvious. They're spices, they're fruits, they're like these things. Some of the things I passed around earlier. We can come up and look at these in a moment. But a lot of the things are kind of halfway between medicine and witchcraft. And again, witchcraft is very much a part of it. Fertility, this is a fertility dolly. Yeah, you can see. Yeah, and pass it around, pass the fertility. And it basically is, it's a fertility thing, you know. And so they you know, would apply medicine and you take various things and the gods will make you fertile. But, or there's other things like spices, such as some of these. There's lots of poisons. It's unbelievable that in a day like today, a woman can go and buy things to punish their husbands. Yeah? You know, it won't kill them, but something will drop off, you know, or they'll get sick, or, you know. And it astonished me. I was working in the garden with 100 people, and they were like, oh, John, his wife. She don't find he's been very naughty, so she punished him. And what happened? You know, his toe fell off, you know, or something weird like that, you know. But he got seriously punished. So there's lots of wonderful things, you know. I mean, I know Cassandra would give her life to spend a week in this market. She would be like, oh, look at these things. Bring them back. Yeah? I don't want to dwell on fertility and all that, but for the gentleman amongst us, there is. You know, a lot of people, mumble jumble, it doesn't work, yeah? Plant products, they don't work. But triatropine, yeah, that works. Strychnine works, yeah? Quinine works, tobacco, nicotine works. There's a tree called yohimbe, and that works, yeah? Definitely works. They've seen it work. Not me, but it definitely. You all familiar with the yohimbe?
Yeah.
Yeah, Paul Sinister last year, yohimbe. It's a tree, and it does work. I mean, what am I saying? Look at James. James is my son. So what did we get from the forest? Fuel wood, it's obvious, but we got, you know, numerous things, mushrooms. I mean, this is a shopping list, yeah? You know, if I'm going to Kroger's, my wife's like, pick up this. So where are you going? I'm going to the forest. So I'll get this lot. Yeah, all right. So like all this sort of stuff, yeah? Robes and all sorts of wonderful things, you know? And it is surprising. And what I was getting back to you earlier, the value of a forest isn't in the wood that some guy in the West can make profit from, yeah, or a builder. It's in these products. And nobody's measuring the value of these products, yeah. Ever heard of this? No, I want you all to write this down. Just write this, a boga, yeah. We have some of these. I'm going to pass some around, I think. Some of them have already... Have you all sniffed some of these? You did? Oh, we'll come up and sniff them later. So all of these are spices. This is pepper that you put in food, yeah? But it's not black pepper, because that's Piper nigrum from India. This is Piper guineensis, yeah? No. Oh, it's around the wrong way. Sorry, I've got it screwed up. That's Evingia gabinensis. This is Piper guineensis in any case. And that's a spice that would have been used in pepper, but it wasn't. It was replaced by black pepper from India. All of these things, Molodora myristica is African's version of a nutmeg, yeah? And Nicia clarantha, if people got hepatitis, they used to make a tea from this and drink it. Why did they do that? Well, you ask somebody, why would you do that? And they're like, well, because when you rip the bark off, it's bright yellow. And when you get hepatitis, you go bright yellow. Yeah, or malaria, you go bright yellow. So, and I had malaria numerous times, and I went bright yellow. But this didn't, and so they associated the colour, yeah? So you go to the doctor, and he'd, you know, put this on, and he'd get his dong, 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 and he'd say, take this, and it would be disgusting, yeah? But it probably made you go more yellow than the hepatitis, so it disappeared. But the thing is, now modern science is looking at this, and they found that there's compounds in there that are really good for hepatic diseases. You know, somewhere back there, somewhere there's a root to all of this. Anybody figured this out yet? Iboga? No. All right. We'll come to that. Is this okay? Is it too scrambled? Or it's good? Okay. I'm very insecure. Okay. You go through the forest, yeah? This is not a peach, yeah? This is Garcinia cola. So if you're walking along and you've had a hard day at the office, yeah? And they're like, okay, well, you need a cola nut, yeah? Or you go to anybody's house in West Africa, they give you a cola nut. And that's, you know, a big pink thing that you chew. If you're poor and you can't afford a cola nut, you have Garcinia cola. And basically it's a mild stimulant. It picks you up, you know. This is the real cola, Cola acuminata. This is another cola. And this, all of these are here. This is Aframona meleguida. Now, most of you have probably never heard of grains of paradise. Yeah, it was the first spice to come out of Africa. Very first spice. This is one. Yeah, I'll pass it around. And it's really peppery and it's spicy. And it's the thing in the gin that gives the gin the thing, yeah? It gives it the flavour, yeah? But it was brought to Europe 500 years ago by the Portuguese. And what they did, they were using it to preserve meat, yeah? And perishable goods. Guess who uses it today? Sam Adams. They put it in the beer. You know why? Because it makes the beer last longer. And it's a member of the ginger family. But it's a really important spice. So you're walking, and this happened to me numerous times, you're walking through the forest and you find it and it looks just like this. You pick it up and chew on it and it's delicious. Okay. Now we're going to look at something else. Okay, so if you want vegetables, you go to the farmer's market and buy your veg, yeah? But there are vegetables in Cameroon. It's hard to grow vegetables. You grow tons of starch, you clear the forest, plantains, bananas, yams, and cassava. But vegetables are a different kettle of fish, yeah? And for 1,000 years, people, the Bapindi people, Bangi people, used to eat this vine. This vine is a neetum. Does anyone know what neetum is? Are you familiar with neetums? No? Neetum's a conifer. It's not a dicot. It's actually considered, and we've got them at the Botanic Garden, it's considered to be the evolutionary bridge between angiosperms and conifers. Wherever neetums occur, they only occur in the tropics. They're either trees or vines, and you can eat them. If you eat this uncooked, you, as a survival food, hunters do it when there's nothing else to eat. It gives you chronic gout, yeah? So you don't want to eat it uncooked. But what happens is this plant, which used to be common in the forest all around Cameroon, has been pushed to near extinction because people have harvested it for hundreds of years. And it's a base plate with a huge industry. You can actually buy it in the United States now. And basically, they take the vine from the forest. So women, of course, who do all the work in Africa, get on a bus and they go 300 miles to the Yaoundé province, and they go into the forest and rip this down by the ton, yeah? And they bundle it all up and they have to bring it back. Or collectors go out and collect it and bring it back. Then when it comes back to the village, they're sold in various markets as bundles, and then someone sits there and they shred it. They shred it like this with a really sharp knife, yeah? They shred it. And then they take the leaves and they put them into boiling water and they stay real leathery. They boil it for a while and it stays real leathery. Then they add some little tiny weed that grows around where this comes from called water leaf. And as soon as they add that, it turns into a sludge. It's very strange chemistry. Then they stir it, then they pour in gallons of palm oil, boil it up, and serve it as a food. And it's one of the most important foods in Central Africa because pound for pound, it has more protein than fish. It's incredible. So it's really, really an important thing. This is palm oil, by the way. It's disgusting. So, as I said, it supports this entire industry, yeah? And each stage in here is money being made from the process. Now, we talk about over-harvesting. Has anyone got any idea what over-harvesting's about? What do you think of that? Yeah? That's over-harvesting. You could sit in a bar eating this is called fufu and eru, yeah? Eating this, fufu and eru, sit in the bar, this is the main road between Yaoundé and Limbé, and you could count 100 of these in a week. That's over-harvesting. That's not even the locals picking their share. So at the Botanic Garden, we worked with locals. We learned how to propagate this from cuttings, and people were like, that won't work. You can't grow it from cuttings. But we did. And then like, well, if you can, it won't taste right. So we did blind tastings, yeah? And that worked. And then, oh, well, no one will want to grow it. So anyway, 5 years, 6 years later, now in Limbé, thriving industry. All these women are growing their own eru in the garden. They have to leave the trees up, yeah, or in their little farms. They sell a pound, they eat a pound and sell 3 pounds because you can harvest it all year round. And the last time I went back, which is 5 years ago, a lady came up to me and said, with a six-year-old child, and she said, this little girl, she's alive because you guys did this. Because what she did was she didn't have to go the 300 miles. She'd have to spend the money on transport. She put the money into the quinine, the anti-malarial drugs that saved that little girl's life. You know, that has an impact, yeah? The species is now being cultivated throughout Cameroon and Nigeria. And the stuff's starting to turn up in the Atlanta markets, African markets. Okay, moving on to something else. So Vindia gabonensis. This is I want you to pass this round, yeah? It really smells bad. So this plant comes from this huge tree, Vindia gabonensis. Bush mango produces a fruit the size of a small peach. The fruit's quite delicious, but you can't eat it because it's too tough, yeah? So what do? You send the kids off to the bush for a few hours, and the trees all fruit at the same time, yeah? And they fight the baboons off, and they collect up the rotten fruits all over the ground. They collect them up and they put them in cans and they bring them along, and then they give them to mummy, yeah? And the mum, she can't get that flesh off that fruit, no matter what she does, yeah? She could pull it in a meat grinder, she could throw it against the wall, doesn't matter what she does, it won't fall apart, it's full of fiber. So what does she do? Common sense, she sticks it all over the outside of the house, yeah? That's what she does. She lets it turns to a tarry, nasty, stinking mass, and then she splat, yeah? And she splats it all over the outside of the house. Imagine the flies, they're everywhere, yeah? Like, it's incredible. Look at that, amazing. And the table, look at the table. And she does that. And then what happens is over a period of a few weeks, it decays and gets eaten, and all the seeds fall off, yeah? And then she collects them all up, and she's got them in this tray, yeah, and she'll take that to the market, and she will sell that for the equivalent of $60 for a bucket, for a 5-gallon bucket. Africa, $60 is a year's salary. This is worth so much money that even the men go and collect it, yeah? And it's worth a lot of money. And so no one grows this tree for three reasons. No one, no one knows how to. Two, there's never any seeds left because they eat the lot. And four, it takes 100 years for it to fruit, yeah? So, but we had a program where we were checking, we're looking at the diminishing of the genetic pool in the forest because of harvesting. What do they use it for? Well, the funniest thing is, as I was telling Cassandra earlier, a Nigerian will kill for a bowl of this stuff, yeah? Because it's the national food of southern, south-eastern Nigeria, yeah? It's called a bongo, yeah? And what they do is they grind the seeds up and they boil up a kettle of water and they throw the seeds in the water and the whole thing turns into this really slimy mess that smells just like that stuff. And then what they do is they put the spices, food and fish in there. And then when it's served, it's a draw soup. So people will sit around with a bowl like this and they can do this and then slop and it kind of flies in. If I do it, it kind of flies somewhere else. And if you ask for a spoon, they laugh, because they want to see a European trying to do it. And it is quite tasty, but in recent years, it's been used as a major slimming agent because it's got some really interesting compounds in it that is being marketed now as a diet agent. Prunus. Anybody know the family Prunus or a tree, the Prunus? Yeah, cherry, yeah, cherry. So cherries occur all over the world. And they certainly occur there. They only occur in Africa, cherry and apple. Yeah, they only occur in Africa at a couple of thousand meters. They are high altitude tree. They like the montane. And if you go into the montane forest, you see these huge prunus trees. Well, in the 60s, scientists went there in the 60s and were looking at, there's a company called Planter Camps, French company, and they were running around Africa desperately trying to find cures for cancer and the cold and stuff, and they were trying all these herbal products. And they came across people who were harvesting the bark of Prunus africana, and they were like, what do you use it for? And people were like, we'll make it into a tea, yeah? We boil it, we steep it in alcohol, we drink it, and it lowers the fever. And it does, it's like a acetaminophen. But they thought it cured malaria, but it doesn't. It just lowers the fever. Most Africans in this part of the world have a natural resilience to malaria in any case, so they get through it. But when Planter Camp took the compound back and tried it, it didn't do very much at all. But what it did do was it was a miraculous cure for that infliction of fat, older, overindulgent white people, white men, yeah, who get swollen prostate and they're up 10 times a night and everyone's getting cheese, you know, it's just misery, yeah, and not that I suffer from that, of course. and it really works, yeah, and so Planter Camp has tried as hard as it could to try and find out what the active ingredient is, and they just couldn't figure it out. And what they found out was it's hundreds of different compounds working together. This is a true herbal remedy, and it's now marketed as ProStar. But it was started marketed in the 80s in Europe, but the American pharmaceutical government, the pharmaceutical people, they would not allow it here until year 2000, because they could not figure out what the empirical chemical was. So because you couldn't say this is the active ingredient, they were like, well, it's gibberish, yeah? So for another 20 years, all these American guys who were walking around like this and did without the healthcare, yeah? So now it works, but the problem with that, as soon as the US licensed it, this was the result, a mass exploitation. And traditionally, you would harvest one side of the tree and then come back and harvest the next side of the tree 5 years later. But as soon as this came on the market in the US, we went to Mount Cameroon, which was a stronghold of this species, was trees were being cut off, trees as wide as this board were just being dropped and stripped in primary montane forest. So one of the projects we did again was to basically grow thousands and thousands and thousands of these trees and put them back. This is the example of a tree that was just chopped right down and stripped. And it went from a few hundred pounds of bark a year to thousands of pounds of bark a year coming off. So these guys will get up at 4 a.m, they're in flip-flops and machete, they run up the mountain, which is like a marathon, yeah? It's a real hard grind to get to this, where it's wet, it's cold. They get to where the forest is, they harvest all day long, they climb on ramshackle equipment, such as this. That's what they use. This is their climbing harness. Imagine that on a wet skin. Really awful, yeah? And I'm sure a lot of them get killed. They harvest the bark, they make it into these makeshift packs with rattan, they run down the mountainside, and they drop it at the collecting station and get the $25. Serious work. Cola's really interesting for you guys, Atlanta. You know, you go to anywhere in an African town, anywhere in Central Africa, people will hand you a cola nut before they offer you anything else. They'll shake your hand and hand you a cola nut, yeah? Because that's the culture. The Muslim societies, they use cola all the time, cola and coffee. It's a cousin to chocolate, theobroma, but this only occurs in Central Africa. And of course, it's very important to Atlanta because Coca-Cola is one of the primary ingredients in Coca-Cola. And it always struck me as curious, I understand why they use coca, and originally it was, you know, when it was first conceived, it was white, it was a red cheap wine with coca leaves dissolved in there. But how did he know about cola? You know, what was his name? Candler or Proctor? Whatever his name was, the guy who invented it. Yeah, he came back from the Civil War, was brutally wounded, and was taking a wine that came out of Italy. It was an Italian wine with coca leaf in it, and it relieved the pain, got you off of laudanum. But he came up with this. And of course, the only place in the world where they were exposed to cola and coca was Portugal. And about 2 years ago, there was an NPR article about these. They were going down the Portuguese beach, talking to fishing people in these villages, looking at life in general. And this guy said, yeah, we've had Coca-Cola for what, 500 years? Like, their own version. And not like our Coca-Cola, but that's where somehow he must have got the idea from. Afrimonum, again, we just talked about that. The Portuguese used it as a spice. I'd passed it around, but there are lots of afrimonums that are, there's only two, there's Afrimonum meliguena, which is the primary one used for the grains of paradise as a spice and for treating, for making preservatives in beers and meats. But there are lots of others, and a lot of the others are locally used, and they're very spicy. And just a small grain is like you pull it in your mouth, and it's almost the equivalent of chewing on a red hot chili. It can last all day. So there's a whole world of afrimonums that aren't explored. And as I said, gin and Sam Adams are the things they put them in. Okay, one shocking experience for me was this plant, and I've got this in the conservatory at the garden. So a favourite trick of the rangers when they were hiking on Mount Cameroon, after a hard day's hiking and you're really dry and you're really thirsty, and they see this plant from Archococcus growing all over the place, and they pull up the pod and they're like, try this, it's delicious. And you pop the red pods in and you chew them, and they've got these three seeds inside. And they're really nice. It tastes like a gin and tonic. Again, it's like afrimonium. It tastes like really spicy and it's refreshing. It makes you salivate. It makes you feel really good. But then it hits. Yeah. It hits. It's like suddenly these seeds, which are bullet hard, turn into a mass of kind of weird jelly. And the whole thing tastes disgusting and you spit it out. But of course, by the time you spat it out, it's too late. It's a sugar mimic. And what it's done is it's told your taste buds that from that moment on, for the next day, everything you eat is brutally sweet. And it really is. It really is amazing. It's really sweet. And of course, yeah, it's been looked at in thermotin B is the active ingredient. And two things to say about this plant. This was the first African plant to be an issue of countries' ownership rights on plant material. Because Tate & Lyle, a British sugar company, took this plant from Central Africa, took it to Ghana and grew tons of it and tried to make a sugar replacement. Cameroon didn't get any money, but they stood to make billions, so it went to the international courts. The other thing to say about this plant is, has anybody here been to the Fairchild Botanic Garden in Florida? No? You have? Yeah, of course you have. Yeah. David Fairchild and Montgomery were two very wealthy and very, very enthusiastic plant collectors. And there was a picture that I found that they spent some time in Limbo Botanic Garden in the 20s, yeah? And they loved Cameroon. They just loved it. They collected as much plant material as they could. And then I read their report and they said, people, fantastic. Food, amazing. Yeah? Place, beautiful. But the beer is so sweet. And I laughed because I knew what they did, because they went in the forest with the rangers and they did this to them. And then, of course, traditionally, you always take the rangers some beers and food afterwards. And they were like, the beer's so sweet. Why is it so sweet? It's because they fell for this. That's really interesting. Botanists always fall for the same tricks. Ancestral Cladus, not much to say about that. It was a plant that was, they looked at this plant as a treatment for HIV because it had these two really powerful compounds in it. But most of them were so toxic that they couldn't, they could never be used. But they've come up with another compound that's going to be the next generation of anti-malarial drugs. This was only discovered in 96. The thing that it did do, though, it did show, lead the way for bioengineers to come up with the anti-RNA drugs that are used. It was a part of that. But it's a very, very, and the point is it's the treatment that it's going for is the malaria that kills you in 24 hours. Cerebral, other malarias, you can survive them, but cerebral malaria, and I've had it three times, is absolutely devastating. And that's the one that's losing it, all the medications are not working for. Stravanthus. I've got this growing at the garden. I was going to bring a piece, but I wasn't allowed to bring it, actually. They don't like it leaving the garden because it is truly incredibly poisonous. It's a stunningly beautiful thing. This is the flower. It's about this big. And these tassels hang down about this much. And this is still used today. This is Baka people, what they used to call the pygmy people, it's Baka people. And they use it in bows, crossbows, and blowpipes. And they use the seeds as a fish poison too. But this, they can kill anything with this stuff. And you know, one man's poison, another man's medicine. Today, they're still doing this. They're still hunting with it and sometimes, of course, killing each other with it. But it's also today is used as a powerful cardiac. It's a powerful cardiac toxin, but it's used today for Orbain. It's used in the place of dioxin. Got to apologise. I haven't done this talk for a year, so I'm somewhat rusty. But we have a fantastic plant of this at the garden. It's okay, another plant that was really important in Central Africa is this thing that looks like a huge gardenia. It's got flowers about this big, and it's a really beautiful plant, Vakanga africana. And it produces these like seed pods about this big, and they look like melons, you know, little melons, and they crack open. And as soon as they crack open, everybody picks them. And they use that for all sorts of medicine and stuff, but and it is a very, very powerful poison. It's related to that plant we talked about earlier, Iboga, which we're all going to look at in a moment. But and today it's used as a part of a process for reproducing Iboga. We'll talk about Ibogaine is the compound. But it was a really important plant in the 80s and 70s and 80s because it was one plant that was being harvested wild from the forest and bringing international income in because it was a source of the oxybrain. It's an anti-migraine drug that was a really powerful medicine. And the way it works is it opens up all the capillaries and it allows more blood flow to your brain. And the traditional use for this was headaches, in any case. So, you know, I think one lesson that I've learned is there's always a seed of truth in a lot of these medicinal plants that people, traditional societies, use. And the only reason we then follow up and discover these cures is because we have that little seed of information. But if those people disappear or be replaced, all that information's lost. When the missionaries went to Nigeria, there was this awful tradition of punishing women mainly and each other, but secret societies would carry these like chicken claws that had been sharpened or stabbing these little knives, and they would have them in a little container. And the container contained an extract from this plant, phytosigmin, and that is incredibly toxic. And if anybody cross someone important, they would just scratch them with it, and a few days later they would die of a really horrible death. And it was one of the things that pushed the Mission Society really to get hold of Nigeria. It was one of the many things. And they tried to ban it. It was also used for trial of ordeal. If someone accused me of a crime and I said, no, I'm innocent, they made me take the stuff, and if I died, I was innocent. Or guilty. If I didn't die, I was innocent. But you would always die from this because it's really vicious stuff. But today, again, you know, one man's poison is another man's medicine. It's been developed into quite a powerful drug. So it's, and as it says, Alzheimer's and glaucoma, but there's lots of other traditional uses for this too, all over the continent. You're familiar with the periwinkle? You all know this. Major impact on, but you know what got people interested in this was that this plant ended up in Jamaica, and people in Jamaica were saying it was good against diabetes, and it was the research from that led to finding these compounds. So it was really interesting, but it isn't directly linked with Africa. Okay. Strange thing. Anyone been to Jamaica? Yeah? You recognise this, yeah?
I'm from Jamaica.
Oh, you are?
Yeah.
Okay. Is it good?
Personally, I don't really like the texture, but everybody seems to love it, so I guess so.
Yeah, it's interesting. It's a national food, isn't it? Yeah, Jamaica. And if it's not cooked right, it's quite toxic, is that right?
If it's not open. If you pick it when it's closed and open it, yeah, the fruit inside is toxic.
Yeah. So it's a really interesting thing, but the most interesting thing about it is this tree doesn't occur in Jamaica. This tree isn't native to Jamaica. This tree is native to West Africa. But if you go to West Africa today, you won't find anybody who knows how to eat this plant. Yeah? You won't find anybody. The information was lost because the people who did that were exploited. I mean, they lost all that information, went with those people on those boats. And that really made me think, you know, it's like, why are we seeing Blyia sapida growing in West Africa when it's a native food to Jamaica? And I did some reading. You understand, you see the name Blyia? You know who that's named after? Anybody got any ideas? Has anybody heard of Mutiny on the Bounty? No? No? Okay, well, that's named after Captain Bligh. Captain Bligh was a Royal Navy captain, and he was sent to the Polynesian Isles to collect breadfruit, and they were going to bring breadfruit and take it to Jamaica, and they were going to feed slaves with it because it was a cheap and easily, it's a huge fruit, it's like Artocarpus, it's a big moracy thing. I don't like it myself, it tastes really ew. Anyway, so they pound it, bake it. I guess you've eaten that too, yeah?
They roast it most of the time now.
You like it?
I prefer it fried.
I've had it boiled, funny enough.
Yeah.
But it's kind of gooey and sticky.
Yeah.
But so when they t- So when Captain Bligh was trying to, you know, collect up these trees, so that the ship, they went to the Polynesian Islands. You got all these boys from London, yeah, like in 1730, never seen a palm tree. They end up on this gorgeous tropical paradise, yeah, and they get there and it's too late. The trees have already fruited and everybody's eating the fruit. So they're like, well, we have to sit around. So the botanist is like, the Kew botanist, Kew Gardens botanist, he said, no, what we do, yeah, we'll take cuttings and give it 6 months, we'll ship the whole lot back to Jamaica, yeah. 6 months is a long time when you're in a tropical paradise with beautiful girls and lovely food, and you know, London is so far away, England's so far away. So of course discipline broke down, and Captain Bligh was a staunch disciplinarian, and he tried to lay the law down, and they followed initially. So they basically, he went round and everyone was getting tattoos and no one was wearing the uniform, and he was getting really bent out of shape, and even his second in command got involved in all this. They all started having families with the local girls. That was enough. Get them back on the ship. So they all got on the ship and they put hundreds, thousands of these potted plants. The ship had been converted to be like a floating nursery, yeah? Thousands of these plants on the ship. And they all sailed off, and Captain Bligh was thinking, everything's calmed down, we're all okay, lay a bit of discipline down, they'd be fine, give them an extra rum, they'd be okay. But they all started missing the girlfriends and stuff, yeah? So then they got really bent out of shape, and they basically, in a nutshell, revolted, put Captain Bligh in a boat with 28 other people, one cask of water, no compass, no log, the logs at Kew, and threw the plants in the ocean, yeah? And then the captain, then the HMS Bounty, it was called, sailed off, and they ended up in the Pitcairn Isles in the South Pacific. And Captain Bligh, who was in the middle of the ocean, not miles from anywhere, he navigated from memory, and he to this day holds the world's rowing record. They rowed down to the Dutch East Indies, yeah? Jakarta, somewhere down there somewhere, got rescued, and 5 years later went and rounded the lot up and strung them all up. Anyway, so when they fight, and then he did it all again. Yeah? He sailed, he got back to Kew, and they were like, well, you've got to go back and get him again, yeah? So he went on again. So he went off, and he finally got these trees. He took them to Jamaica. They grew them, and no one would eat them. Yeah? So all that trouble for nothing. So they noted that and his good friend Hooker at Kew, director of Kew, he said, that's all right, William Bligh, we'll just rename their food to Blighter. So they named that tree after him. Isn't that astonishing? Yeah. Arrogancy of the Royal Navy. Okay, here we are. This is where the fun gets going. You need to leave the room. No, you're fine. Okay, so these two guys, I knew these for years, these two guys. They always used to turn up in my church. And So this is the magical Yuhimbe. This is a magical Tamananthi, yeah? Tamananthi boga. Okay, so it's in the Apocynaceae, and it's a plant about this big. It looks like a really ugly tomato plant, yeah? And it has these big yellow fruits, as you can see. And it's a plant that occurred around Gabon and all that area, yeah? Gabon and Lower Equatorial Guinea and Southern Cameroon. And it's always been the cornerstone of a religion called the Bwiti religion. And what happens is when the French missionaries finally got into Gabon, they were astonished that they couldn't make any impact. You know, they couldn't convert anybody. They even built churches, yeah? And all these people would come along, but no one would be converted. And it was because this plant had more persuasion than the French missionaries. Now, what is it about? So, this plant contains a compound called ibogaine, and I was really, really lucky enough to go and see a ceremony. That isn't where this came from. I got this off the internet. But I was lucky enough to be invited to go down and watch a ceremony, and it really was quite shocking and striking, yeah? So, people take the plant, and they take the roots, and they strip the skin off the roots, and they make it into what looks like tobacco. And then they have a ceremony where they all decorate themselves. This is modern, and they sit around, and they burn akumia torches. This is a flare. This is one of these. And they basically, they have a bowl of water, And they have a minder, somebody looks after them. And they start eating this stuff, and they keep eating it and drinking the water. And then they'll vomit sometimes, sometimes they won't, but they'll keep eating it, keep eating it. And then what happens is they go into this really strange state where they just go stiff. No, the first, it's a two-phase process. The first phase that can last anything from a few hours to 2 days. They go into this really kind of manic state where they're really active and moving around, and that's where the minders come in, they control them. And then after that, they go suddenly slow down and they sit down and they go rock rigid, like really stiff all over. And they go into this really strange state where their brain is going through an accelerated and extended period of REM. And over a few days, they come out of this, yeah? Why is it interesting? Well, during that second state, they believe, and they are quite convinced, and there's some evidence, that they go back in their life, they run right through their memory bank, and they shake out all the memories, and they vividly remember things that happened that no one else knows about. And lots of research has been done, and people say, yeah, that really happened, yeah? But then they go beyond when they were born. And this is where it gets really crazy. They go beyond to where before they were born and they talk to their ancestors and they solve problems and ask questions and gather information. And then they come out of this. And what's been really strange, they tell stories about things that no one else knows about and things that people do know that they said, yeah, that really is true. But the other thing is they've got this really strange ability to remember hundreds and hundreds of different things. So people have like run through numerous numbers, they've done strange mathematical equations, it's really weird stuff. And no one really knows how it works. The other thing that's happened is in the 50s and 60s, there was a guy, this guy died a couple of years ago actually, he's just a guy in New York. He had some money and him and some friends went down and they were wealthy, they were exploring, they were traveling around doing all sorts of drugs and stuff. And some of his friends were hooked on various drugs, and he himself was drinking too much, he was an alcoholic, tobacco was there. They tried this stuff, they tried the ceremony, and when they came out of it, some of his friends were cured. And so he came back, and he was astonished by this, and he decided that he was going to try and set up a company and try and figure this out. He got closed down by the feds. The federal government stopped him in his tracks. The seeds always, I've seen the plant and the seeds look like little brains. It's the creepiest thing. When you pour them out of the pod, they look like little brains. Yeah? They even have what looks like a little cerebellum. It's really strange. And of course, you know, lots of research has been done on this. But it really is true. It does. Two or three treatments cures you of these addictions. There are numerous private clinics in Switzerland and the Capos Isles where people, rich people, send their rich, spoiled kids to get cleaned up. And but I would suggest you get on the internet and look, because it's very, very interesting. There's lots of theories why the federal government stopped this in its tracks, and the international pharmaceutical companies did too, but you should look it in your books. Have you studied this?
We haven't gone over it yet. Yeah.
Next time I'll bring some samples and we'll give it a go. No. But it is a really interesting thing. And for me, it's like one of the most sinister plants that I've ever worked with. We've looked at this. We've looked at that. Oh, okay. So now we're on to just things like fibres and stuff. Yeah. Any questions about pharmaceuticals? Are you all bored?
No.
I am. You sure? Everyone's glazed over. Okay, if you can drink this, I'll give you $50. Okay, this is indigo. Okay, one thing that really got me excited in Africa was okay, you're walking along, the truck breaks down, yeah? Land Rover broke down on the on a really bad riverbed, yeah? All rummaging around, 8 hours on it, 6 guys in it, crack, yeah? Breaks down. And we look under, and one of the big springs had shattered, yeah, broke completely. And the driver's like, "Tar, no, we can't go any further." This guy looks, he goes, no worries. And he goes off into the bush and comes back with this huge piece of cane. And he's like, wriggles around, stubs a rock in there. And sure enough, it got us in the next 100 miles to where we wanted to be. And another guy, you know, bust stuck in 6 foot of mud, you know, nothing to pull it out with. They go off again into the bush. They come back with something they'd spend 20 minutes nailing together, tow the bus out, stronger than steel. You know, these guys, they just find this stuff, you know. We drove for hundreds of miles going down the Gabon to watch the guys get whacked up on the boga. We drove for hundreds of miles down the mud road, stopped, and out of nowhere came five or six different people. Like, they were there, you know. This is forest, not the high street on Piedmont, you know. There they were. You need a lift? Can you give me a lift? Have you want to say, you want to buy this? No? You know, dead diker, you want to buy this? No, why would I buy that? And they're there, they just turn up, you know. And the funniest thing was we had the old-fashioned GPS, you know, it used to make a lot of clicking and and we were doing some surveys, and we saw a plant that we collected, and one of the guys put it down. You used to have to turn it on and leave it and for it to get a signal, yeah? And we drove off and left it. And we came back about half an hour later, because God forbid, it was like 500 quid's worth of equipment. And there's like five or six bushmen standing around there, prodding it with a stick. Click, 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 click. And my friend Terry just, give it, it's mine. And this white man picked it up, and they're like, what? Where did you come from? Where do you guys come from? Anyway, that's a distraction. Yeah. So there you are, right? You're living in the rainforest, and you're like surrounded by huge trees, yeah. And you haven't got anywhere to live, and you haven't got any, you know, and you haven't got any baskets or whatever. You haven't got any of this stuff. So what do you do? You know, you can't cut those trees down. If you cut them down, you can't do anything with them because they're rock hard. Yeah. I mean, any, you know, even a chainsaw struggles a lot of the big trees. So what do you make your daily utensils from? You make it from the palms, yeah? Three things about palms. They're the third most important plant group in the world as far as utilitarian and food's concerned, yeah? You can make anything from a palm. If you lot were dropped in the middle of a rainforest somewhere, anywhere you want, yeah? There is no need to starve, yeah, because you walk along, you're going to see palms, you crack off the crown shaft, rip off the leaves, you've got the most nutritious, high carbohydrate protein food you could possibly wish for. You just keep walking along, chewing it, eating it, swallowing it, it's fine. There's only one palm in the world that's poisonous, and that lives in Madagascar. If you need a basket, you make one from the palms, yeah? And the two groups of palms that really, really matter are the raffias. And from the raffias, you make baskets like this. And this, it's the soft thing. You make the mattress that you would sleep on. You make the roof to your house, yeah? And the other group are the rattans. And the rattans are both palms. Raffias are like, you can see this man here, yeah? This huge thing. And you can eat the seeds. They're really disgusting, but you can eat them if you have to, yeah? You crack them open, eat the endosperm. They're disgusting. If your daughter decides to get married, you find the queen palm, which is a queen raffia, which is basically a huge raffia palm. It's just about to give flower. You cut the flower off, tap the sap, and tap it into a container, and it spontaneously ferments into the most powerful mind-rocking wine you could possibly drink. It's really strong. And then if you want to kill yourself, yeah, you distill it into what is called a fufu and turn it into palm whiskey, and that's really dangerous stuff. But you use that for other things too, like lamps. And I've even seen a small motorbike powered by a don't need petrol, blah, 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 blah. And it goes, yeah, it goes off, and no worries. Or you can, cut, when they do flower, these things are flowers that are 20 foot long, comb off the little yellow flower buds, fry them up, and they make a fantastic omelette. Yeah, so there's so many things you can do. You can tap sugar from them. You can weave them into skirts. You can make a really nice cocktail dress out of it. I mean, it takes some work, but but they are incredible. So palms really are the source of life in the tropics. And you can make these very attractive masks. And of course, the baskets, some of which we've got there. The rattan, rattan's a different kettle of fish. Rattan is mean, nasty, and old-fashioned, yeah? This rattan here is growing at the Botanic Garden. There are about 200 species of rattan, only occur in the Old World. New Guinea, Australia, India, Southeast Asia, Africa, yeah? And all of them are really, really hard to work with. But what they do is they're a climbing palm, yeah? And they're the ancestor to palms. So palms, yeah, the modern palm, you know, stick, brain on the top, yeah, really stupid design. Stick, the brain on the top, covered in leaves, yeah? So the first storm that comes by, or hungry explorer, snap, and that's the end of that palm, yeah? The rattan doesn't do that because the rattan knows that sooner or later a fire's going to come through, or an hungry elephant's going to come through, or an explorer. So it buries the bud in the base, yeah? And then it grows in there, so it sends up a cane, you cut it off, it'll send two more. You cut those off, it'll send five. Yeah, so it can go forever and ever. It's also completely armoured. You would not believe the spines in this thing. I am covered with scars from these and from the ones at the Botanic Garden. Some of these, most of them will grow 120 feet. Some are this thick, and some are never get any thicker than this. This is a rattan from the conservatory. So when you want to build a bridge, yeah, or maybe you want to build a chair. And of course, the $200 million a year export industry of building nice furniture, you go to the forest with your buddies, and families own these trees. They own them from generation to the next. And you cut them off with a machine, you scrape off the skin that has all the spines on it, and you get down to the cane. And then you and your buddies pull this thing up the tree, and I really guarantee it's not a fun exercise, because as you pull, it pulls back, and as you pull again, stuff falls out, snakes, dirt, filth, bees, everything falls out of the tree. And it takes these guys a long time to pull this down. They cut them into 12-foot lengths, yeah? They wrap them all up, 12 canes of 12-foot lengths, wrap them all up, put them on a frame. In the old days, they used to soak them in coconut oil or palm oil. Nowadays, to make them bend, look golden and crisp like a fry, and make them durable, they boil them in oil. Yeah? They drop them in diesel oil at 190 degrees Celsius, and the whole thing's like a huge fish chip fryer. So they have this big metal tank in the forest with a fire going under it, and they light paper and stand well back, and they really do stand a long way back, and they drop these things from a rig into the thing, and they leave it in for 5 minutes, pull it out, lay them on the side, cool them off, and then when they've done that, they can build one of those, yeah? So what do you need a bridge? I mean, you know, they build bridges, they build boats, they build baskets, they build everything they need. They traps, they build cages for animals. It's incredible what you can build. And there's places in Equatorial Guinea where people build houses from them too. So, and in Southeast Asia, a whole community are built from them. So another, you know, a really cool plant that where I was working, we brought Asian, Southeast Asian artisans in to teach the Africans how to instead of using nails to hold them together to develop these amazing knots that these guys, hundreds and hundreds of different very fine knots to build high quality export furniture. You can also build houses. These are different types of houses built from rattan and raffia as a door. This is a sacred temple that me and my wife were allowed to explore. Very strange place, very eerie, huge. Now, the last but not least, everybody likes honey, yeah? So if you're in Africa and you want to get honey, what you do is you find the honey guide, yeah? And you catch it. You catch this little bird, it's about this big, and you pull it in a little cage, and you put a bit of honey alongside it, honeycomb, and you don't feed it for a couple of days, and it's like, I want honey, I want honey. So you basically, you pull a little bow on it, yeah, on its leg. You put a little string with a bow on it, or you put it on a lead. And these guys let it go, and it flies off, and it goes straight to the first bee's nest. Yeah, and then what they do is they take a rattan, and they tie sticks together, and they make this ladder, and it might go up 100 feet. Then these guys make these outfits from raffia, and they go up there with an axe, yeah, and they chop out these really angry bees. Yeah, they come flying out, and they're really, really mean. And these are really dangerous bees, and they chop the honey down, come down, and then they feed the bird. And that's the, and then the bird will stick around, you see. Isn't that cool? How long do you think people have been doing that? They look great too. I'll wear one of these. I almost put mine on today, actually. I'll cross my mind, shall I put my honey guide coat on or not? No. What a cool place. Anyway, there we go, Limbo Botanic Garden. I'm just going to give you a little insight into what, well, I don't know how much time we got left, but what are botanic gardens for? You know, really, what are they for? And, you know, most people, botanic garden, are there to see the flowers, yeah? Or, oh, yeah, they have music, yeah? No, they, you know, they do, but there was the real reason we have botanic gardens and have always had botanic gardens is for the study and development and distribution of plant and protection now, conservation of plant material, yeah? Plant products, plant materials, plants, yeah? So botanic gardens go about hundreds of years. Real botanic gardens are on the cutting edge. They're on the front line of conservation, medical, botanical research, all sorts of cool stuff, yeah? But they are also very beautiful. These collections of Roystonias that were put here in 1850 by Paul Proust, Professor Paul Proust, who was a German botanist who was sent here to establish Limbo Botanic Garden. These plants weren't decorative to him, they were research. He was researching their potential. This is, you know, the this palm here? This is Copernicia prunifolia. This palm here, it doesn't look much different from the rest. This is the palm that produces carnauba wax, yeah? And that's, that, you know, they grew these plants in an organized fashion so they look good, but the purpose was to research, can we grow a plantation of carnauba wax in Cameroon? They did the same with the palm oil, and they did the same with tea and coffee. They also did it with huge numbers of ornamental plants and vegetables. So they went to this strange and wonderful new land, they carved out a patch, for good or for bad, and they brought stuff in from all over the world, and they tried to find out what could grow there, and the main drive behind it was to make life as comfortable and as safe and as rewarding for both the local people and the invading colonists as possible. And so they're quinine growing here, coffee, tea. I saw these hedges all around the town, these hedges, and I noticed the goats would always go up to these hedges, chew on them and just hang around, yeah, and then they look really weird afterwards. And I looked at them, and in my former years, I was on a medical plant program, and I looked, they were cocaine, yeah. None of the locals knew, they used to call it privet, yeah. And well, it was, I looked through the archives, and the Germans introduced it because they had a perfect experiment. They had a mountain, yeah, that was a killer to climb, and they had a botanic garden, and they introduced these bushes, and they were doing experiments where people were taking the coca leaf and running up, the soldiers were marching up these mountains and marching against guys who didn't take the coca leaf. And I found all these notes. Okay, so the work carried on. Well, my own little modest contribution of 8 years was one of the last things I did there in 2003 was to rescue this very rare palm. It's not a rare palm in Africa, but it's Borassus. Borassus, one of the largest palms in the world, and it come from the other side of the Mount Cameroon where it was being logged because they wanted to grow cassava. And we collected the whole gene pool. We sampled and collected the whole gene pool. It was an old Pliocene lake that had dried up, and it was just there. And it's the fruit that the elephants chew on, and they get drunk, and they fall over, they defecate the seeds. So when you fly over, the palms look like they're in lines, but the further away they get from the centre, they get more and more bendy, because the elephants, you know, they kind of drop down. drinking. The elephants drink so much, I'm telling you. Don't buy an elephant a drink, yeah? So we planted these, and then that's 2003, and I looked on the internet the other day, and I saw, now, they're like this big, yeah? It's incredible. But that is the second wettest place on the planet, so. So just one more slide. So what was our mission was to find these plants here. All of these plants, we had a program called Conservation Through Cultivation, yeah? And our objective, and this has been done all over the world, is to collect these, work with local people, collect these plants up, this is a little prunus tree, and to work with the local people, tribes, schools, government, everybody, town council, yeah, and to get them to plant these trees out on their farms and in their forests. And in the 5 years that our prunus program ran, we had 18,000 trees put back into the wild, yeah, and at least the same put onto the farm. So we didn't give these away. We got people to collect, come down, they bought the seed, they grew the plants, we showed them how to do it. All we had to do was provide some guidance, yeah? That's all we did. And this is the first slide, the Neatum Africa, the Neatum, the Eru and Fufu, you know, that green slimy stew stuff. This is us showing kids who did not believe that it could be grown because it was magic, yeah? Showing them how to take cuttings, showing this old guy how to grow them in the propagator. And all the propagator was a box of sand, of sawdust and a plastic lid, yeah, polythene. So we bought in all these, no chemicals, no rooting hormones, nothing fancy, just common sense and some basic materials. And that's what botanic gardens should be doing on the front line of conservation. If you don't, there's a few things to say. If you don't provide these stakeholder communities with an alternative, if you want them to leave the wildlife and the forest alone and you go out there ranting and raving and telling them they're doing this and they're doing that, they're going to do what anyone would do. They're going to tell you to go back here. Yeah? If you leave the trees in and we show you how to grow this and you need the trees to grow this, instead of producing $50 a year, you can produce $2,000 a year and you still got your trees. And the species survives, population through cultivation, and the kids get fed, and the family has medicine, money left over. There's a reason, you know? And if you can do it with all these spices, you know, of India, $60 for a bucket of this smelly stuff, yeah? Not much, you know, we don't care about that, but the people who make their life from it does, yeah? This is the message that we have to do, we have to give. And this is a success story, yeah? When I first went there in 95, they just started to root the Eru. When I left, there were over 40 nurseries. We formed a little union, not a political union, but a little union of Eru growers. Everybody put a few dollars in the can. When they needed pruners, they paid for them. This gentleman made sure that all the farms were managed correctly. And now you can buy this in the African markets in the United States, wherever you find a Cameroonian community. That's it.